Hi everybody, I am Omni Rusted. Welcome back, well, or welcome to, if this is your first time seeing me, to Thea, The Awakening, Return of the Giants. Thea is an amazing game that I saw recently on Twitch with one of my favorite streamers, Avic. And so I decided to try it out myself, and it's very fun. The problem with Thea, though, excuse me for my throat, getting a cold. Problem with the game though is it has an inner tutorial mode with videos, but the videos are just terrible. They're just some guy playing the game. He doesn't actually explain how to play. So I thought I'd actually explain how to play today. We're gonna add a new game. Oh, that's loud. Let's turn down the. Wow, the audio is not that loud. It's just loud to me. Well, I apologize if it's extremely loud in-game. I will try and make things as... I'll try and explain things as I can. That's better. Anyway, so you start out in Thea the Awakening with two randomly selected gods among the Scandinavian gods. It's all based on Scandinavian mythology, which I think is an amazing job. And as you play the game, it actually adds a lot of replayability in by making it so that when you end a game... as one of the gods, you gain some experience in the god's progress, and that unlocks different things. And as you reach, I think it was, reach level 3 on any god. When you reach level 3 on any of the gods, you can see I only have level 2 on most of them, or level 1 on Horos there. It gives you another randomly selected god, except for apparently these ones... you can only do by finishing the game by completing the Cosmic Tree quest, or unlocking all the gods to get Perun, which is the ultimate god. I have unlocked 4 of them, Morina, Mokash, Horos, and Zoria. Basically, god of warriors, god of the night, goddess of earth, goddess of death and rebirth. And depending on the experience and how you've been doing, it will basically give you more gods to choose from and more abilities. We're going to be doing this on difficult today. I'm going to be choosing Mokash because she's my favorite. Gathering is huge in the game, so a bonus to gathering is great. I'm going to be starting out with warriors, though, because we're starting on difficult play. So we're not going to have many gatherers at first, but we'll see how we can do. And you can, of course, customize the difficulty, but I don't. And it changes, depending on the... It changes your ending experience. So let's start as Mokash. The Mother Earth, life, birth, and nature are your domain. You were once the supreme goddess, ruling alongside Perun. But now everything has changed. The darkness devoured your beloved Thea and tarnished all life. You kept a handful of chosen worshippers alive in the bosom of your power. Hot. But they are weakened, lost, and scared. You must do all you can to restore balance and keep your people alive. So the game basically randomly generates a land for you. And it can be quite difficult. We'll see how things go once we get in there. Sometimes you can start with a random, just horrible, horrible matchup. I'm really hoping that doesn't happen today. Oh, there's this guy. So this is Theodore. He's basically the tutorial demon. But again, the tutorial is not so good. We're actually going to skip it, and I will try and explain things as we go along. I'm a deity, you know. I already know these things, and I don't need the talk. Skip the tutorial.
Remember to check the magical help button to read more. I know more about any mechanics.
So the tutorial is good. It gives you a lot of good stuff, but if you skip it because you already know how to play, then it does get pretty easy. Yes, I am sure. Craft 10 cooked, baked, or roasted food. Leave it at the village. Got it. Now off with you. And depending on what's going on for each and every event, you will get experience that goes towards your people and research points. I'll explain those in a moment. We start out at the town of Astoya. We're going to rename this really quickly to Rustopia. Now, this is how this is your world map. Of course, got Fog of War, you got your central town. Unfortunately, you can only ever build one town, which kind of sucks, but it works. You've got your different buttons here, research, logbook, I forget what this one is. Oh, that's your town. That's a town button. This brings you to your next group, which you can also do by hitting the space button. It just switches between your town and whatever expeditions you have out. And your resources button, which takes off all of the quest things you might have around, replaces them with resources. I actually started in a really good spot. Wow. So your town has surrounding it. How can I see? There. The yellow bar dictates where they can gather from. This is amazing. 3 wood spots, sandstone, grain, and vegetable. This is the best starting gathering I have ever gotten. That's amazing. This is your expeditions. You can name the expeditions by hitting that little quill up there. And what I do like to do first off, let's just explain things here. So help button is down here. It's again, it gives you a basic explanation of everything. So you might want to read through that if it's your first time. I'm hoping I can explain things to you though. We're going to go straight to getting our expedition. If you hold down the right mouse button, it shows you where your people can go. If you want to cancel it, you just bring it back to the people and release. I'm going to bring my people right back into Rustopia. This is my expedition, bringing them right back. And I'm going to click, you single click to bring up the contextual radial menu, like so. And you've got here, what is that? That is equipment. You can view and assign equipment. This is your inventory. You can view and assign inventory. Move, you don't really need that button. This is to join, or when you're out in the world, it's your setup camp button. I'll show the setup camp. And this will split the expedition. Right now, we're going to join the settlement. Bring everybody back in. Check their inventory. So this is Rustopia. Village overview shows you what settlement buildings you have, maximum of 10. But if you get 10 buildings, you can destroy one. No problem. You end up destroying actually a lot of stuff. Production brings you to what your people are and what skills they have that can be applied to stuff. Now, because I chose Mokosh, her beginning people all have one gathering. It's a little bit of a boost. I usually do it because people will gather things faster. So the one gathering that it gives everybody is not that useful, but it's okay. So let's look at what we can do here. There's also craft. There's 3 bars up here: gathering, crafting, construction. You start out with a basic everything: clothes, cooked meals, craft tools, gathering tools. Right now I'm going to start out with crafting tools. Hit that button there, and it gives you a choice of what you can start with. What kind of materials you have. Now, the materials that you can do change what exactly you're going to do. I've only got 5 gold bars. It's actually pretty cool. I started my own with gold. And some dark wood. It starts you with a random, completely random thing. And the thing is, now I could do regular wood here, but I'll show you what it changes. So the catalyst, it does not matter what's in the catalyst. I'm going to put coal in because coal is really easy to get. And it only takes 2 instead of the 5 wood, and I want to keep some of the wood here. Now, what this is basically our craft tools thing. This the same thing comes up with production buildings. You get a description of the resource if you hover over it. Properties, it'll show you what properties are there. This is just a regular tool, so we don't have any properties. Materials it'll take, or materials it's going to be made of. When you destroy items, which I'll show you later. And then we got craft tools here. This shows what it takes to make it. And here we got, what is that? That is how much labor it's going to take. Then you've got what inventory slot it takes up in your backpack. You got how many research points it's going to get you, which is the most important thing here. And how much it's going to weigh. So as you can see, we did gold. It's the only metal material we have right now. And you can see this is going to give us 2 craft. 7 research points. But if I pick up this dark wood, which is another type of wood, we got regular wood, we got dark wood. Dark wood is a little bit rarer. That ups it to 8 research points, 4 craft points. Takes a little bit more labor, but that's not a big deal. That's a huge trade-off. Absolutely enormous trade-off. We're going to start by making this craft tool. Now, you want to look on the side here. It starts you out with 2 crafters, 2 laborers at any point. Well, not laborers, 2 crafters. What are they called? I forget what they're called. They're called craftsmen. That was it. And it's going to take 192 labor to build this. So we have to make up that amount of labor. When I add one of the people in, it's going to take her craft ability times 10, add that amount of labor in. So for just her doing this on her own, it's going to take 4 turns. I'm going to take Hinio here, to toss him in. It adds his... The major crafter has the times 10. The secondary has it divided by 2. So it added only 20 labor in. I think that's how the math works. Anyway, I'm not actually sure about that math, but it takes less turns, which is fantastic. We don't have any other crafters, so nobody could add labor. If we added anybody else with no crafting skill, it adds a little bit, but only like 2, so it's not worth it to add anybody else in. And of course, there's construction. You start out with a pasture that you can build, but we don't have the resources necessary to build it as of yet. Going back into production here, we're gonna look at the gathering tab. And like I said, you will never get this amount. This is an extraordinarily lucky start. I mean, this is the best start I've ever had. So we're gonna take our gatherers, or our laborers. Gather, they just gather. Hunislav has the best. He can do enough crafting on his own. He's got 9 crafting. So he can do all of the vegetable gathering, which gives me 11 vegetables in 1 turn, which is incredible. Absolutely incredible. On the other hand, if I wanted to put him somewhere else, say on the grain, it would take him 2 turns because he can only throw 90 gathering at that. So we want to actually put him on vegetables. We'll put Derwan here. There's nobody that has 60 gathering to do, but food is the most important, so Hunislav will be on that. We'll put him on sandstone. Derwan will go on sandstone. Agatha will go on wood because you do need a lot of wood. And the rest of the gatherers are actually going to go into the first expedition. Actually, are you... You're a healer. No, I can't put you to labor. We do need fuel. So I will put Derwan towards wood for a little bit. Just a little bit. We have 20 wood at the start. And just to remind you all, the primary and secondary material on crafting are the most important bits. Catalyst, it does not matter what you put down here at all. It does not matter. If you have a hell of a lot of wood but very low coal, use wood. That's it. It does not. The catalyst does not change anything. Only the primary and secondary change the power of whatever you're making. Now, let's go into inventory. Inventory here, you can see your people and you can start a new expedition if you wanted to. So let's... You can hold on shift, by the way. Shift-click just sends straight things into the other window, otherwise you have to drag them. I'm going to shift-click all my warriors and my healer, because the medic is very important. Now, there's a couple things about resources, equipment, and all stuff like that. You can see what equipment is brought with them and who actually owns it. The shield is on Liboslav here. Excuse me. Maybe recording this when I'm getting a cold wasn't the best idea. You can see how much food you have. I'm not exactly sure. I believe it's 1 food unit a day per people in the expedition or whatever. Not entirely sure about that. We've got some heavy armor. Wow, that's a heavy armor to start. I'm actually going to put all of the... Oops, not that one. Not the herbs. I'm going to put all of the equipment into my expedition because they need the good equipment. They're going to be adventuring around. My randomly starting people do not need the starting equipment. Let's also give them some food. I will leave, since my town, Restopia, can actually make their own food, I will be giving most of the food, since they'll be getting, I'll be giving all the food, actually. Yeah, let's give about 10, just in case, so they can eat today. I'll leave 10 in the town, 105 will go in the expedition. You also want to send a little bit of fuel. Fuel is used up 1 per day, but the important thing about that is that it only helps if your people are camping. If your people are camping or producing anything such as crafting, then you need fuel. If you do not need fuel for anything, it is not that important. So my people in town are crafting. I'm going to leave them 5 wood because we'll be getting more wood in the meantime. 15 of this is going to go with my expedition, meaning they have 15 days worth of fuel. They can get some more out in the wilderness. Other things that we're leaving behind are just random resources that we won't be able to use, and children, who are actually a resource, which we'll see what they do later. Let's go into equipment. You can switch up here between the Rustopia and the expedition that you're sending out, and you can see what your people are equipped with. Agatha is a healer. She's not able to carry very much. I don't think... Well, maybe I can actually load her up with something. She's only got 150 weight, which is determined by her strength stat, which is only 3. So it's 50 per strength stat. And she's only got that. I don't think she'll be able to carry very much. We'll actually take this ribcage off Svitoslava... whatever the fuck her name is, because that'll make it up to 150 with the weight. Damn it. You can see the weight is 98. You can see it in parentheses down at the bottom there, where it shows you the properties of the equipment and the materials you would get if you went to inventory and dragged it into the dismantle bay. But Svitoslava is 98. That Svitoslava's ribcage shield is 98. We're going to give this to Agatha because... or Agatha. Because her Bramblewood Club is only 52. So it goes up to 150 there. She can actually shield herself and do some blunt damage. There's a bunch of different types of weapons. I think about 4 different types of weapons. We'll go over their properties later. Now, she does not have any weight. If you try and pick up anything else to put it on her, you see that the weight gauge shows red. Shows you what her weight would be and the fact that she's not able to equip it. If they can't equip it because of weight, they can't equip it at all. Going to Slavslava here. Warriors have an interesting thing. The warrior class can do an interesting thing where they can take two-handed swords, only two-handed swords, and they can equip it on one hand. No other class can do that. That's the main thing about warriors. So she could equip that and the one shield that we have. You can see her strength is a lot higher. Now she's got a total of 8 shielding and some armor and damage. That's great stuff. Level Slav here, he's just got a regular sword. He cannot carry a two-handed axe like that, unfortunately. But we see Svitoslava here only has a one-handed sword. So we're actually going to give her this heavy hatchet because she doesn't have a shield anyway. Swords do give shielding. The big difference... Yeah, I'll just explain the big difference right now. I don't have... Well, I actually do. I don't have spears, but there's swords. Swords give shielding along with damage and can be held in one hand if they're two-handed by warriors. Axes give no shielding but a crap ton of damage. Like, you can see the enormous amount of damage. There's 16 damage there compared to say a two-handed sword, which is 7 damage and 5 shielding. Blunt weapons basically have the cleave or trample ability, where if somebody has a two-handed hammer, they hit something, they kill that thing, and the damage will then, the leftover damage will then push over to the next monster in combat. And spears, we don't have any spears right now. Spears, I hope I can show you that later. So Svitoslava, we're going to give her the axe. Radzim has a shield and a one-handed axe. Maybe I want to give Svitoslava this blunt hammer. We'll do that. We'll do that instead. That looks pretty good. We have one thing of armor. Let's see, is there anybody? We'll give this armor to Svitoslava because she doesn't have any way to block. You see, it's the armor is extraordinarily heavy, almost 200 pounds, or whatever weight limit that is. And we will hand it to Svitoslava here. I'll bring it to 419 out of 500. Then we've got amulets. Now, amulets and tokens or rings or whatever this thing is are special. That's an amulet. They're both amulets. Nope, apparently that charm is not a necklace, and that is. That's weird. Anyway, so basically only certain characters can wear these. Warriors cannot wear anything in the ring slot, but they can wear something in the token slot. Or, damn it, wear something in the amulet slot. So you can see the properties it gives down below in this area when you hover over it and what materials it'll give, but you can also right click on it to see what else it will do. So this gives one will and it is good quality. It's a little bit better than a normal one would be. That's basically what good quality does for you, and we'll explain how to make good quality items later. This charm gives gathering, concentration, folklore. You can hover over the thing, and on the right you can see what exactly it gives towards different challenges. So concentration gives bonus to intellect and hex challenges, gathering, and then there's folklore. I'm actually going to give this charm to Agatha, because Agatha is probably the only one. She's got gathering, she's got medic skill, and intelligence, so she would actually benefit the most from that charm. However, her weight is full, she can't equip it. Now, warriors cannot equip anything in the ring slot, healers can, so can gatherers, so can witches, so can anything else, but not warriors. So warriors can only handle this. We're going to look at our person with the highest will. She's got two, three. So Radzim will get this, so he can win willpower challenges for us later. Now, that used up most of the stuff in her inventory, so we're going to send the rest of it back to town, including this charm. And then we'll go back into equipment, click this button here to go back to the town, and we'll start equipping our people, our gatherers that are staying in town, with the different weapons. That gives gathering. I probably want to give it to my second best, which is Durwan. So I'll give him the charm, so he gets plus one gathering, brings up to seven. Heniel will give a sword. A sword on its own will give four shielding. You don't need a shield, but it's better to have one because shielding just gives more armor and production and shielding. And the last slot here is manage supplies. Manage supplies is what supplies your characters or your people will be using every single turn. Now you can see right here they're going to be using as fuel items allowed for burning. Wood, dark wood, and coal. Now, first off, I'm unchecking allow use of new items. If we get a new item, I do not want them wasting it. I am also going to uncheck the dark wood and the coal because I want to save those for production. They can, of course, eat meat. The food varieties carried give you different bonuses depending on how much different types of food you can be eating per day. We've only got meat now. We might have different later. But you can get some significant bonuses depending on the amount and different types of food they are eating every single day. Right now, we only got one type of food, one type of fuel. Group size is four. It would give them 4 out of 5 movement points. Food supplies, they have 2 days worth of food supplies, 5 days worth of fuel supplies. So, yeah, it is... I'm not exactly sure how food consumption works. But they'll be fine because we've got, gathering-wise, somebody getting a hell of a lot of vegetables per day. We're getting enough fuel. We'll be getting enough fuel for tomorrow. And that's pretty much how we're going to stick with it now. So, out in the world itself, you can switch between different places by hitting the space bar. So it switches between Rustopia and my expedition, which only has 4 days or 4 movement points left. Movement points work in a little way where if it's an empty field, it only costs 1 movement point. If it's a forest or a hill, it takes 2 movement points. Simple stuff. Now we'll look around. We can see a couple places around here that might be worth investigating. We're going to head down this way first because that is a monster place. Now, we're going to start right here by looking towards... excuse me. By looking towards the right-hand bar here. As you can see, we got 21 days worth of food, 15 days worth of fuel. And you can see the weight carried by my expedition as well. This is research points. Now, I said earlier in production, every time you build something, it's going to be getting you a certain amount of research points. It doesn't show right here. Screw it. I'll just show you right here then. This is the research points it will get you when the item is complete. I'm not going to build that right now. And every single time this bar fills up, you get a new research point down here. Experience right here will level up your people and give them more stats. Let's go to the research panel over right away. This is your research panel. So this shows you what materials you know how to gather. So right now, we start out with just the base radial. We don't even know how to gather amber. There's three different tabs on the top here. There's gathering. Crafting shows you what different types you can craft. Right now, we only know how to craft basic meals. And construction shows you what buildings you can construct at the start. Now, I want to speed up my gathering really fast. We can gather straw. I want to gather wicker. Wicker is an amazing fiber that will really beat up my gathering, which is what I want to do right away. I'm going to start with wicker. Every time you confirm a new research thing, it gives you 5 of that item and then shows you a revealed place where you can go gather, even if you don't know where it is right now. Confirm that. And it'll bring up a little thing up here where you can see where your nearest spot is to gather that. I definitely want to send people up after that, but I don't have many gatherers right now. So we're going to cancel out of that, out of the resource mode. Now, there's different symbols that you have on the top and bottom. This showed us where the wicker was. We don't need to look at that anymore. If you ever want to find a different resource, you can go back to the research screen. It will say, you can hover over it, click on it. You've discovered one place where this resource can be gathered. Clicking the resource icon on the top of your HUD will show you their location. Hit OK. Hit Close. Every time you single click on one of these items, if you don't have anything, it won't show you anything. But every time you single click on one of these items, it'll show you how many places you've discovered where you can get it, and then it will put that resource up at the top. So we've discovered 2 places that we can get wheat from. We can click between them here. To dismiss anything up here, just right-click it. Now down in the lower left here, that's what you really want to be paying attention to. This shows you warnings. Oh, goddamn. Let's turn on the music here really quick. I just realized we don't have any music. So, this is where your warnings are. So this shows somebody, one of my expeditions has a food supply low. You can click on it, it will bring you exactly to where it is that has low food supplies. That is way louder than I want it to be. Anyway, let's start walking around. I'm going to go down here first. We can probably reach this turn. It looks like some ruins. So anyway, now that we're here, you can click to show where is low food. This thing says it's low food, but we planned exactly for them having low food anyway. Going back here, bring up the radial menu on these ruins that we found, and it'll change this. This is your basically contextual thing. It'll bring up a thing where you can search the location. Now this is your event window. It changes depending on options that you have available. You can see I have 4 options unavailable. Depending on the skills that your people have, you will get more options. Blue means it's a special contextual thing, meaning you have the skill to search, for example. If you can't do anything, it'll only give the option to leave. This is a difficulty marker, so it shows on a scale of 1 to 5 the scale of the danger of what you're doing. So this is easy. This is anything can do this. So we'll search. So we only have the option to fight it right now. This is the challenge fight window. It shows you skills used in this particular challenge. We'll be using offensive skills. What we're facing off against. Udo peaks are actually pretty hard, but oh well. Now, we have options right here to auto-resolve if you think you can just beat it anyway. And then begin combat. We'll show you the combat screen. This is the combat screen. It's basically a card game, which I think is really awesome. You have the people who are in your party to choose from. It randomly selects where people are going to be going. This is the half that is tactics. This is the half that's offense. Your opponent also has the same thing, but you can't see their cards. Clearly. Now what you have here is your people's HP plus their armor value. As you can see, we're all pretty low right now. And then you have their weapons with the different types depending on slash, piercing, blunt, or... Well, it's only slash actually because axes and swords are both slashing damage. And you can see what they have and what they can do. If you hover over anything, you can see blunt damage right there has a description. And then depending on the amount of shielding that a person has in their equipment from swords or shields, and wow, that's loud. I cannot affect the I can't affect anything right now. I can't go to the options right now. But you can see the shielding gives them extra HP, and then their weapons have different effects on them. My people only have poison effects right now. So starting out, I want to send out a heavy hitter. Damn it, cat. I want to send a heavy hitter first off. Unfortunately, because I'm playing on difficulty, I didn't get a change where people were. So my heaviest hitter, my heaviest hitters, plural, are both over here in tactics. So I'm going to send out Radzim first. And as you can see, the shielding goes into extra HP. As long as... Oh my god, 18... Oh, that was 18, damn. That's a lot of damage and a lot of health. He will not be able to defeat this on her own. As long as the HP modifier, the plus sign, stays above your actual HP, your people will not come out of the battle wounded. If your people come out of the battle wounded, they have a chance to die. So, we see the Udo Peak here has 18 damage that she can do, but 22 plus 6 health, that's a hell of a lot. So very likely Radzim, well, there's actually no chance, actually. Radzim will not be able to defeat her in one shot. So very likely she will hit him. So instead, there's a different thing you could do called Confuse. Now, as you can see, the Warped Snake has this question marks on it. It was brought in from the tactic side. Anything brought in from the tactic side comes out confused. So it will not, fighting has two phases. It will, if they're confused, they will not attack in the first phase. This gives you a chance to do damage, and of course, damage goes left to right. So, we see Radzim has 15 damage he can do. He can bring the Udo Peak down to, let's see, do some math. Oh, I'm terrible at math. 8, 7, 13, 13 health in one shot, which will not kill her. We don't want her to damage Radzim because she can easily take him with one shot, so I'm going to go over to my tactics side right here. And I'm going to choose to confuse her with my tactics. Now, the tactics works in these numbers on the side here show what they can do. I can give Radzim some shields for 8. I can give him first action, but he is not level 1. The 1 on some of these determines level. On the other ones, it determines what they're going to give. So, the confuse ability has level 5. The Udo Peak is level 5. I'm going to confuse the Udo Peak so I can make sure I can kill her. They bring in another snake from offense and their warped snake. All four of them now are up against Radzim. This could go very badly. Now, I'm going to... but we can see there's little things next to here which shows how many cards you can play. We got one card in our discard pile, which was the confused card we used. But now, because we're going last in this round, we have 3 cards we can use. We only have 3 cards left. So, I'm going to bring her out. She'll be confused, but she can do damage next turn, but she does a hell of a lot of damage. I'm hoping she can work. Then we're going to bring our last two out. They'll be going last, so it doesn't really matter. The only thing that will be going right now is this Warp Snake, which only does 1 damage. We go into the first fight phase. Good, he hit the Udo Peak. The Warp Snake hit him. Somebody killed the Warp Snake. Fight phase now, round 2. All the confused things now go. Radzim has taken a hell of a lot of damage, but it seems we're going good. And you saw the blunt damage traveled over to the next one there. Radzim took some damage. Radzim and Svitoslava, Slavka, I'm not even going to try and pronounce these names, took some wounds, so you can see they're now wounded. They're not at 0 HP, though, so they are not in danger of death. We acquired some armor, some iron, some steel, and some seaweed. Seaweed is food, believe it or not. We take the stuff and leave the place. We got 2 experience, 1 research point, and it gets rid of the ruins. Now, let us go look in our inventory. We're going to go to equipment, and I want to look through because somebody is getting a new thing, armor. It's only 9 armor, 1 shielding, which isn't bad. So I'm... No, Svitoslava's got pretty good armor already. Let's give it to Svitoslava. And that was the only equipment we got. Otherwise, we just got some materials we can bring home. But the music just keeps going up and down in volume. Now, I want to continue on, but to the spider's nest, but I only have one movement point left. One movement point should always, if you have it, be put into camping. If you have wounded people. It takes a movement point to camp, but while camping, you can gather resources if there's any resources around you. There's no resources close enough around me to gather. That's basically how you make extra towns. But you can definitely go into your inventory, check your people's health, as you can see. Radzim there is 4 out of 10 and has 6 wounds. But depending on your medic skill, it lowers wounds every turn. So basically, you lower wounds each round, but if you're camping, you have a better chance to gain back wounds or heal wounds. So I'm going to keep them camped overnight so they'll hopefully gain some of their wounds back, and then we can go into combat tomorrow. So that's the first day. I explained a hell of a lot. I hope it helps. There's a lot of different things you can do in this game depending on what you want to accomplish. Let's go into production crafting. I'll show you really quick here. You can, for example, I've got some silky spider silk here. So I can start, and I could totally make a shirt that's just leather and string. And that will just make a leather shirt. It just gives 1 research point, 2 armor. Whoop-de-doo, not very exciting. It's a 20 weight. Anybody can use that. It's only 1 research point. You want to make sure the research points are always high. So instead, what I'm going to do, take out the string, move the leather material to secondary material, take the spider silk, put it as primary, and then again, the catalyst doesn't matter, so we're just going to put string there because we have most of that. It gives me a silk tunic instead, which is 3 armor but 7 research points and 16 weight, which is so much better. I will confirm that. Now, for the current task window, once Neelma and Hinio here are done with this production tool, they will automatically move down to the next one on the list. You can put down a lot of different material, a lot of different jobs, and they will just keep moving up and down. If you want to change the priority of different things, you can just say, I wanted to do food next. The up and down arrows will change the priority. There's also different buttons on the right here. You can see the plus and minus. As long as you have the materials down here, say if I went to 3 materials, it shows I do not have enough wood to make that. So I can make 2 meat stew. If you want to see what your maximum is, this brings your number to the maximum you can make. And if you don't care, you just want them to continually make it forever, hit that, and they will continually make meat stew. So basically what I would normally do is say, oh, I want to cook some meals. Meat, herbs, wood. I'm always gonna have meat and herbs and wood. So go ahead, always make meat stew. But hey, I can make a gathering tool. Actually, I'm not gonna make this gathering tool right now. So let's look. String. We don't have enough wood, so let's put some coal in for that. That's 7 production, 3 gathering. Does leather do any better? Leather makes it a bit heavier, so we're not going to use leather for that. That was the only thing that changed. See, our research and gathering doesn't change. The weight does, so I'm going to make it out of string in that. Confirm that. Oh, that's below. Okay, I want them to finish the gathering tools before they work on the meat stew. So they will go production. Once that's done, they'll go to gathering tools. Once that's done, they'll make meat stew. And anytime I have anything that I want them to make, I just, once all these production things are done, they'll be working on meat stew. I'll put that silky vest above that. That way they'll go production tool, gathering tool, silky vest, or silky tunic, and then the meat stew. So whenever they're not doing anything else, they will make meat stew. That's basically how that works. Construction is a very different kind of creature. I don't have any materials to make to construct anything right now. That'll be much better. But I do have sandstone and some vegetables, so I will be able to make that soon. And anything made in the construction tab goes into your settlement buildings. They do an effect every turn. You can see the pasture. Let's see. Can I see what it does? Can I see what it does? It does not hover over. Anyway, we'll go into the research tab and I'll show you what it does in the construction tab. Pastures give 1 meat a turn. And you can unlock different things. Cabbage fields will have a chance to give you babies. Herbalist will have a chance to heal your people and cure sickness. The smithy is one of the important ones. If you're producing a lot of stuff you want to have a smithy. Every one smithy, depending on what you put into it, gives a percentage chance when you're constructing new things. I do not have enough material to make it, but as a chance when you're constructing new things to give you a percentage chance to have good items. And you saw the good quality and the bad quality is it's a math thing, but it helps out. So a smithy will give you, has a chance to give you good items. And I think, do we have good items in here or no? So we have a bad quality sword here. It's in some way worse than other similar items. So any other items of black sword made from quartz and dark wood, this is worse than them. On the other hand, do we have any good items? Doesn't look like it. What about the expedition? Do they have any good items? Nope, we have a lot of bad quality items. No good items that I can show. Oh, what? No. This apparently is better. Good quality items is just in some way better than similar items of the same make. So, let's go to day two. So, every time you go past a day, it brings these things up here. Now, the difference here is this is a resource income. It shows that somebody on your map in your game got gathered resources. What this is it shows that in Rustopia, we got 6 wood and 11 veggies. We can cancel that. This is the villager's idol. Someplace in either an expedition that is camped out or your town are idle villagers. So this shows that in Expedition 1, nobody was set to do anything overnight. Don't really care. This shows that I have production things that are that do not have anybody assigned to them. Not a big deal. So, we'll get rid of all of that. It shows that Rustopia still has low food, but I don't care. They're fine. I know they're fine. So we're going to go to our expedition. Up here, it shows you can break camp. And we got 5 movement points to move around. Let's go hit the spider's nest. So we don't have any hunters or anybody with an herbalism lore. It only gives us the option to fight. Now, 6 malicious spiders. They're only a 1 difficulty. I know I can take them. We're going to auto-resolve. 1 experience, 1 research point, and we got some spider silk out of it. Pretty good. Now, those the places like that, which are basically monster dens, like that spider thing there. There's another something over here. No, there's another spider thing there. They will, every few turns, pop out another monster. That's why you want to keep them clear, unless you want to like farm them for silk or something. I'm going to try and explore roundabout, and we'll see where this goes. Now, I don't have anything else to do this turn. I know that my people are still crafting. Oh, and we have some monster movement. We probably want to chase that down. Oh! This is what the children resource is good for. Your children grow up into things. Now, I have plenty of warriors, I have good crafters, I need more gatherers. So, Igor has now joined us. And that took away one of my child resources, but I got a gatherer. And I got experience for that. So, next day, we see that our experience bar has filled up. Now we got more resources at Rustopia. We have villagers idle. Because Igor has not been set to do anything as of yet. And then, because our experience went up, our expeditions, or our towns, people leveled up in them. So we see people in town. Igor leveled up for 1 gathering. Wow. Hunislav gained strength for some reason. I don't know what he's going to do with that. Hideo became stealthier. He does not look like a very stealthy guy. Now, my expedition won. Lubislav got more strength. Agatha got more will. Fit person got 2 tactics. Sleslava got gathering for some reason, and Radzin got +1 HP. Now, this is when things get difficult. So, you see, this went from orange to red. It shows there is no food at all in Rustopia. Because I forgot, I disallowed use of new items, my people have not been eating the veggies we've been gathering. So they're fine now. Let's go into production. Igor's got an 8 gathering. That's really good. And I want to start gathering some sandstone for the buildings that I want to build. Igor's got 80. So he can definitely be gathering some sandstone. That's going to be fantastic. Now, every day, we got one more day left on this craft tools to get all the labor filled up. And then they'll move straight to gathering tools after that. We do not have the resources to build a pasture, so I won't worry about it. Going back to the expedition, let's continue our exploring. Can't pass over water, we'll have to go around here. Ooh, I forgot I need to go with those rats. I'm sure they're fine. Now, these guys are right on the hex next to me. I do not have any movement points left, I can't attack them. Hey boy, who are you?
The boy does not answer, only smiles at you and starts to play with the ball. But he remains close to your group and glances at you from time to time, as if waiting for something. His golden eyes measure you with the tenacity of a wild cat playing with its prey. You think this may be the fabled treasure boy, a minor luck demon who can bring much fortune. But what was the way to get it? There was something about its head, or face, or body.
So, because I have enough folklore, I have some different options here. So, but it doesn't tell me which one it is. All of these are blue. It basically means I've opened up this option with my amount of folklore. We have three options then available. I'm assuming if we have more magic skill or more folklore skill, would open up more. But I don't remember what to do. Let's slap him. Apparently I did the right thing. He gave me 5 gold and 7 silver. That's really good. Yay, 2 experience for doing it right. Now, you can see up here, there's different things up here. There's resource income, that was of course in Restopia. Now this is the important thing. This shows me, because it's green, that the production on the hammer is now complete. You can see they automatically moved to the gathering tools. Gonna go to equipment. This gives 4 craft. Incredibly useful. I'm gonna go to production, I'm gonna look here really quick. Nylema has the highest. I want to give her that first. I'll give her that. That will bring her craft up to 9, which will incredibly speed up anything going on here. You can see our labor went up to 110 instead. Now, because of the fact that Hinio here has pretty good craft, I can put him down here to Silk Tunic, because she will be able to finish what we need in the laboring in just 2 turns. And he'll be able to finish this 1 of 4, so you can start throwing some labor at this, 40 a turn, and she can finish this on her own in 2 turns, so there's no point in having Hinio up there right now. If I switch them around, let's see if Hinio was up there. It would take him 4 turns, but this is a much better option, because she can finish this like almost right away in 2 turns, and the gathering tools need to be done quickly. So, going out, there's also a new one up here, which is enemies spotted. If there are enemies on your screen, you can click on it, it will bring you to them. So, stake expedition 1, attack these undead. It's 1 unliving corpse, 2 broken skeletons, it's a 1 difficulty, I'm just going to auto-resolve it. Now, they were apparently a little bit tougher than I thought, we did get some wounds, but they're not bad. And we got a shield, and we got a monster bone from it. And let's go explore this thing now.
You stumble across some ruin. You open one of the buildings. A strange-looking stone and metal-built affair. And you hear a clicking noise. Then, a blunt thud. Before you are able to do anything, you see a skeleton charging your way.
So we have to fight. 1 skeleton, 4 hulking rats. It said it was a 1 difficulty search. I feel safe auto-resolving this. We got some wounds, but it's not a big deal. We got a shield out of that, some meat, some sandstone, and some malachite. And some research points, which are the most important thing this early on. So let's go to our inventory here. I want to look at Svitoslava. She is 8 out of 12. She's okay. People are pretty good still. Let's see if anybody can use that shield. It is a 3-5 shield, and you can hover over like this, and it'll compare it to what you already have. You can see her ribcage, a little bit better armor, but two less on shielding. I'm actually going to keep that there, see if anybody else can use it. Whereas this buckler, compared to his bone shield, what is that? Bone, yeah, ribcage, is significantly better in weight, armor, and shielding. He will get that. And that means we have this bone shield left. I don't know if anybody can use it. Oh, it is already better than Luislav's shield. I don't think anybody is bad off enough that they can even use this. Nope. I'm going to go to inventory because I know nobody else is going to want this thing. And I'm just going to dismantle it. Dismantling it shows you what you'll get from it. It was pretty worthless shield, so we got rid of it. We did get another shield, however. The Pavis is a really, really good shield. I know it's going to be better than somebody's. Replace that there. I don't think anybody wants this ribcage. She can't even use it. So we'll destroy it. Get some bone and wood back from that. And let's continue on. I do want to give Svitoslava some chance to heal. So I want to make sure I have one movement point left. I will head that direction and then camp out for the night. Now this one actually has some things I can gather around it. So I will take my people and I will put them all towards gathering cherries. I do not know if we'll be able to get the labor up. Ah, we do. We have just enough labor to get one thing of food out of this overnight. I'm not going to stay there more than one night. Now, we can see right now we have two gathering places here. Rostopia shows me what we got. So does Expedition 1. Break camp. Continue on. Let's see overnight. Svitoslava, Slavka. Got all her health back. Everybody is fully healed. That is the wonder of having a medic. I love medics. Search. One difficulty. It is another Udo Peak. I'm just going to let it go. Svitoslava got hurt again, but not a big deal. So, we got some good stuff out of that. 5 steel, 11 amber, which is great. We got a new pitchfork and some scaled leather. That is a great haul. Let's look here, and I will equip somebody. Well, I'll at least show you this. Now, here is a piercing weapon. This is the only weapon I wasn't able to show you. Piercing weapons, card deals damage, dealing piercing damage is placed in front of the last card and deals half of its piercing damage without additional effects to it, but only when the last card is an opponent's card. I will show you that in the next. It is a little bit better than the hammer. I will equip her with that. I will show you that in the next combat. I cannot attack them right now. Svitoslava, Slavka got injured. Let's see, can we gather some wood overnight? We just can barely. We'll get some more wood while we're out. But one of the important things we got to look at right now is production was done on something last turn. We got enough research points. We have a new research point to spend. Let's see, I like that we have the wicker. I want to start working on something else. Let's go. We've got sandstone. We do not have stuff to really get armor yet. We don't have any leather or metals. So it would be pointless to go for metals right now. I am going to go towards the herbalist's hut. No, not that. Yeah, let's go for a cabbage field, because that can use sandstone, some veggies, and some regular stuff. We can definitely build a cabbage field, and getting more people is always great. I don't think we have the resources to get either. No, they're both redded out. We have the veggies to get it. We do not have any. We do not have enough sandstone or wood. We should next turn. So we can see the gathering basket's done. Let's go back to Rostopia here. Go to construction, and first I'm going to build. How are we on food? We're doing pretty good on food. Let's start with the cabbage field. Now, sandstone, and we got some veggies, and then some regular wood because the catalyst doesn't matter. This will have a +2 to attract human, a chance for human to join your village each turn, and it has a chance to attract children. It's great. Now, my people are already working on this. Once they finish with this, I'm probably going to move them to construction. This turn, though, however, we want to make sure Hunisla, or maybe Derwan. Probably Derwan. I mean, they all have the labor to complete these things on their own. So it doesn't really matter who gets the gathering basket, but Durwan has the lowest. So we'll go to Durwan here. And we'll hand... This is the tool plane thing right here. Tool plane. We'll give him the gathering thing. It'll give him... What was that? 3 gathering. Which brings him up to a total of 10. So he's now our best gatherer. We're pretty good for resources right now. Let's go to Expedition 1. Break camp. And I'll show you what spears can do. Round 1. It's random who goes first. I'm going first. Let's show sex lava. I don't know. Alright, now the important thing we gotta think about. We got one card we can play. He has 19 health, but I'm gonna show you here what piercing damage does. So, she is in the tactics pane, but piercing damage can still work. So, we're gonna hit the get closer button, which will confuse her. She will still hit him with her piercing damage, doing half of her piercing damage, and then goes in front of the last card played. Last opponent's card played, as long as it was a monster card. If, say, I put Radzim here and then tried to play Svitoslava past Radzim, it would do nothing. Ooh, he used his tactics to confuse me. So now I have only one person going. She will definitely be able to kill the broken skeleton, but she might hit the unliving corpse at the same time. So let's get Agata out there, and then let's confuse the unliving corpse, because the unliving corpse has a lot of health. Hopefully we can get everybody to team up on him on the second phase. She hit the broken skeleton. Excellent. So everybody will then point their damage at the unliving corpse, and these two can easily kill the unliving corpse together, and then we'll kill what's left in their discard pile. Easy win. We got a buckler and some monster bones. I don't think anybody can even... It's not a very good buckler. It's a little bit lighter, though. Anne has better shielding. We'll give that to Agata. And she now has 10 points cleared up. Which is great, because that means that she could probably get an amulet or something that she could use as well. So that was actually really great. Checking out what we discovered. We discovered a lot of stuff. We discovered a coal source. A source of grain. Source of fruit. Let's continue moving on. The cabbage field has no production on it, but the silky vest is done. Let's go back to Rustopia. Now they automatically moved down to working on the meat stew, but I don't really care about that, so we're going to go to construction, drag them over, and get them on the cabbage field because we want to start attracting more people. It says we have enough to make a pasture. So it's the same kind of thing with that. Once they're done on this one, they will move straight down to the pasture. Pastures give one meat a turn, cabbage fields can attract people. However, any building you have, and this is important, any building you are making... has a chance to attract people, depending on how good it is, and how impressive the material you're using on it is. If I used just 25 things of wood on each side, it would not be as impressive, it would not attract people. Let's continue traveling around. I want to scout around my home for any really good close gathering spots or any monster places. That's what I'm planning on right now. Now, we have a silk vest done. Do I want to equip that to anybody? Not really. I want to give that to my warriors. Oh, right there. We need to go hunt them down. Great, worth checking out wherever wounded or poisoned. Now the herbalist hut. Oop. Hi there. Well, let's just wave at it. Okay, continue on with my day. I'm assuming if I had more folklore, I'd know what the hell that was. Hey, I got some experience for it. We gained a level. Let's see, we got some health, some feint ability, and some intelligence. We got more strength, more will, more health, and Svetoslav is really getting a lot of tactics. That's pretty impressive, actually. Let's continue on. I'm going to try and avoid... Ooh, what is this? We discovered some more sandstone. Not the best. I was hoping for some better stone type. Oh, well. I don't know if the skeletons... they are still there. Good. Let's go beat them up. Auto-resolve. Damn, she gets injured a lot. I don't know why she keeps getting injured. There's some bones here. So that's a bone resource there. And it looks like we actually found an amber resource actually particularly close. And it looks like there's a spider's nest here. I do not have the movement to take care of it, though. Let's go there. Auto-resolve. Get the silk. Now spiders can't spawn there. Try and travel along the outer edge of this and scout our way around. More bones. And let's go up here, search this sucker. Skeleton hulking rat. Let's actually go into combat, because Svetoslava keeps getting really injured. Okay, now the randomness has put Svetoslava in first. However, she has piercing. I don't want her to go in as the first combatant. We'll send in Radzim first, see what they do. They put in a hulking rat. He's got 8 hit points. Oh, they put in a skeleton. Crap. But that skeleton is confused, so we're going to put in Svetoslava. She's going to do damage to the skeleton. Now, the order of things is what we'll pay attention to here. We know, for example, Radzim will do 16 damage. He will hit this rat for 8 damage. The rat will die. Svetoslava will do 17 damage to the skeleton. The skeleton will die. We will put an Agata here and see what they do. She only does 5. It's not very good. It will not be enough to kill the hulking rat. We do not have anything that we could do to give her more damage, so I'm just going to confuse the rat. So that she has 2 chances to hit it now. They put another hulking rat. Now, the thing is, Agata, being the last person here, could randomly hit any of these rats. So, she could, for example, hit that one, kill it, well, do like 5 to it, and it wouldn't die. And then this hulking rat could hit her, and then all of these can continue to hit her. I'm going to give her more shields to make sure she can go through with it. Dead, dead, and then the 2 here will be able to help her kill these rats. I should make sure, just in case, Agata can live through all the damage that's going to be put in towards her with shields. And then Agata hits that, and it's dead. We won. Now, the reason we won there... Ooh. Nice. A spear. Very good. Very good. Lots of iron. Very nice. Anyway, now the reason that rat died, Agata's club here only does 2 damage, and with her strength that equals up to 5, so she only did 5 damage, but it was poisoned. If you attack a runic creature in combat, the poison damage is doubled, so technically she was doing 6 damage. If it had already been wounded, she would have been doing 7. There are several different weapons that have stuff like that. Let me see if I have any others here. We don't have any others right now, but there's poisoned, there's leeching. We're actually going to head back to town right now because there's equipment waiting for us. So, it looks like the cabbage field is done. As you can see, it's right here. And that brings me up to 1 out of 10 buildings. And they moved automatically down to the pasture. It gets darker. I don't know exactly what time the turns take up. It's something to do. It says it's daytime, but there's a moon out. I don't understand it. Daytime cycles between morning, noon, afternoon, evening, midnight, and dawn. So it's nighttime right now. It's not midnight. We still have a little bit of visibility. But your visibility will go down. Another reason why it's heading back. Anyway, so the expedition's home. Let's drop off all the stuff they picked up out there. Let's drop off the grain, the silk. Let's see if they want to equip any of this stuff, because a spear would be really awesome. It does not look like she has the strength to carry that. Svetoslava, is that a better spear? It is not. We don't want to give anybody else that spear. So I think we're good to just transfer the stuff back to the town. And let's see if our villagers can equip any of it. Your villagers, you do want to give some stuff because they will eventually have to protect themselves. We can give them a shield. Nimla, we can give... you know, let's give her the spear instead. And we'll just, let's see, which one is better? That one's better. It's a, see, there's the difference between good quality there. This one is 5-4 and 1 dexterity. That has 3-4 and is just normal. That's the difference with good quality there. Go to inventory, we'll destroy the unequipped shield. And we'll transfer over the silk tunic and see if anybody wants some armor. It is 16 pounds, Agata cannot wear it. She has armor, he does not. It's a little bit of armor, it just increases their HP when they're in combat. I like it. And because we're gonna be, it's gonna be midnight soon, we'll just join the town and we'll just set my people to helping out with labor here. Maybe get some more grain. I don't know if they can, no, they can't add enough labor to help with that. But we're going to be waiting anyway, so we might as well help out with the labor here. In fact, let's see. They might be better off gathering wood. They can't get the labor up there. Can they do it if she helps? No, not in one turn. But we'll wait here 2 turns, and we'll get Durwan to help out with the grain. Now, puts him first off. Can he do it alone? He can totally do it alone. There we go. Now, in 1 turn, they're going to be gathering all of this stuff. We got enough labor on all sides, just barely over the 63 mark here. And the reason that's 63 is because I'm working for Mokosh. Or I am Mokosh. It's midnight now, we can barely see anything out. I'm going to wait. It is time for the Night of the Goat. A feast in honor and reverence of the ancestors and forefathers, the so-called Zeity. Great, begin the celebrations. Luboslav learns some folklore. Wonderful, if forever cursed, we shall seek out this city. And now, up next to the herbalist hut, which is interesting, they're right next to each other, we also have a way to not only cure poisons and sickness and wounds, we now have a place to cure curses, which is fantastic. It is currently what looks to be midnight. I will wait another turn. There's no reason to go out right now. It is now morning. Now it would be good to go out again. Our pasture is done. That will give me 1 meat every turn and have a chance to attract people. Is there anything else we can construct? We could make another pasture or another cabbage field. Let's make another cabbage field. Like I said, you can always destroy these later on. And it's not like we really have anything to craft right now. We could make another craft tool, actually. Let's do that. Let's see what we can make. We don't have any... well, we still have some good dark wood here. And let's look. 56 for craft. Is the silver any better? 80 for craft. But one more research point. I actually want to watch my weight. I'm going to make it another gold one. So let's actually put people towards that right now. And then we'll do the cabbage field after that's done, because we can give that craft tool to Henio. Regular new expedition again. Oops. I didn't mean to bring that guy. Give them some food and some logs. We don't have anything cooking right now. Let's just give them the grain, because we're not using it. They can eat grain. It looks like they have 10 days worth of food. Which direction do we want to explore? Damn, that was both a hill and a forest. Took me all day to move through. Looks like we have another monster spot spawned and another spider nest. We want to go towards that. It's daytime, so we can totally see everything around us, make a lot more out of scouting, but we definitely want to take these down before they start spawning things. And we started working on some of the meat stew. We made some last night, and we finished up this tool. Let's give that to Hinio. And put my production over towards making this cabbage field. 3 turns for that. Can I also make a pasture? Wow, I'm getting a lot of sandstone. That's actually really going to help with building. We got another research point. Got the cabbage field. I'm actually going to start working towards this. Once you research one of these things, it'll open up these next ones. So let's get light armors, and I'm going to go for shields next. But let's look and see if we can actually have the materials to make any light armor. We've gathered a bunch of stuff. We do not have the materials. What percentage difficulty? 175%. So let's see. We do not have the materials to make anything right now. So we won't make it. We won't waste any materials that way. And as you can see, that's spawning more monsters, which are going straight for the town. Let's go take these out. Good stuff. Let's beat that up. Gosh, he gets injured a lot. And then we'll go for the spider's nest next. I could totally farm this spider's nest for silk, but meh. Let's beat it up. Malicious spiders, not even difficult. People leveled up! Yay, it looks like our vegetable patch got done. Neat. Got some more speed, shielding, tactic, strength. No gathering stuff in there. Chest level got strength, intelligence, 2 health, 1 health, 2 tactics. Pretty good. I'm really hoping for, what's her face? Agata to get some more intelligence soon. I think there's a place to explore over this way. Let's go head towards there. Oh, hello. Spores. And we are apparently low on food. Not a big worry. This is a 2 difficulty monster, so we will actually go into the combat thing with this. Let us throw Seslava here. Because she does a lot of damage. We always want a large damage dealer out first, or somebody with a really good blunt weapon. She can easily take that out. So let's get Luboslav out next. And we have 2 cards we can play this turn. Let's actually throw him out here, Radzim. He won't be able to attack this turn, but hey, he's out there anyway. It'll help next turn. Luboslav cannot kill that in one shot. I can't confuse the thing. So instead, we'll damage it a little bit with Svitslav Slavka here. There we go. Now anybody can kill that in one shot. And anybody who's left over will be able to kill the spores here. So let's give Svitoslavka some shields. And it will just be confused tactics monsters from then on out. We might be able to do this without getting injured. Good stuff. And I will easily be able to take these out, no problem. Excellent. We got an enchanted bone. That's one of the best types of bone. Once you've got everything set up, you really go through the days fast. That was a little land bridge here. Interesting. We don't know what this is, we don't have enough folklore, but I'll follow it. Let's give him some food, we got plenty.
Who
Ooh. That is fantastic. Plus two gathering is great. That was amazing. That was good stuff. Now, unfortunately, even if you double the amount of labor done, you can't get double the amount you get here. So it's never going to change there. Let's look at our crafting. All our construction is done, so Nimla and Hinia were actually not doing anything. So we'll get them to make more meats. Actually, let's look at cooked meals, see if we want to do something else. Because we've got significantly more vegetables. We got a little bit of meat, not much herbs. We'll use meat instead. That way we'll be able to make bigos. We can make up to 24 bigos. That will just use wood, meat, and veggies. So we'll definitely do that unlimited. So when there's nobody doing anything else, make bigos. Now the difference, the big thing about prepared food, as opposed to regular food, is that prepared food is lighter. So you can carry a hell of a lot more, determined on your weight.
An unexpected visitor.
Okay, how do we do it?
That's the spirit. I knew we could count on you.
We.
I must warn you, others have tried and failed before you, so the road will not be easy.
So, do you know anything more about what happened to the cosmic tree, or why the darkness came?
I know some, but I do not hold the answers you need to seek. I know that once Thea was a land ruled by high magic, a land where demons were kept in check by the peoples. The cosmic balance upheld by the gods. The pillars of Thea stood sturdy and held our world together. Now the barriers between the lands of the living and those of the dead are torn asunder, and thus darkness holds a tight grip on us. Without your aid, whatever made the sun return may not hold for long, and the age of darkness may descend upon us once again.
All right, fine. So how do we find out what to do? Okay, take the map. So, oop, damn it. Damn it, Teddy, go away. Well, I've already done that, so... Thanks for the material. Okay, so apparently my people are out of food. And they're pretty far away from the village. I should have been paying more attention to their food stocks. So let's see. Basically what that was is it was a quest thing. It gave me a quest to go check out this cosmic tree part. But right now we're out of food. And look around, we got fish and mushrooms here. So let's stop off right here for the day. Send my people to gather us some food. The fish takes more labor than the mushrooms. So we will have no food tonight, which I think wounds us a little bit. But in 2 days we'll have some mushrooms. Let's go look back here, watch production. We're good over here. I mean, we could continue to build. We might as well fill these while we have the chance. It's not like it's really costing us much to fill this area up with different pastures and cabbage fields. That's all stuff we can get on our own. And the bigos are only important to... my expeditions. So I'm gonna leave those so they can't eat them. They can just eat regular crap. Because the town has unlimited weight. It doesn't matter what they have. Seriously, Titty? He gave us 10 topaz and 8 silver. That's really good. But luckily, that is the last... God damn. Oh, disgusting. So, we have enough folklore. We've read about this one. So, we don't have enough folklore. We might be right on this thing, and it might be something else, but we don't have enough folklore to know if it's the trickster demon or not. I'm gonna leave it be and see what happens.
The creature looks spooked by you, but seeing as you did not kill it, it eats a few more bites before leaving. To your surprise, you find a couple of your people feeling blessed the next morning. You now think this must have been a shack.
Well, there we go. More gathering. That's great. It was that or somebody gets strangled. I mean, okay, so somebody is starving. They will not have food until tomorrow, which is bad. And I don't want to waste the labor on these mushrooms. Let's see, does it actually injure them when they're starving? A little bit, I think. We'll stay here for one more turn, get some mushrooms, and then we'll travel on. I feel like my people could survive against this little undead group here if things got bad. They're equipped with good enough stuff. They can probably beat it up. I'm not worried about them. Okay, we have food now. 11 mushrooms. That is 2 days worth of food. We could hope to travel on and gather more. I'm going to make sure we have at least 4 days worth of food. Before I let them go. Yep, they're attacking the town. We won the challenge, so we did beat them. We got a new pavis, but it looks like Igor went down. Now that is actually really bad. That means he's heavily wounded. If their HP goes down to zero, they don't die automatically, but it means they're heavily wounded and could die during the night. The best way to avoid that... Oh, we're getting... We have enough labor going on to... Extra labor from the night before to continue going on. We might actually wait here and get a whole bunch of mushrooms instead. The best way to avoid that is to make sure if somebody is wounded, or heavily wounded, they are camped in town or at a place with a medic. But it's luck. So Igor did die. That sucks. And a child grew up, and he's going to be a gatherer. So Bolilut joined us. And he's going to get all of Igor's stuff. That's a little morbid. Oh well. Let's give him the hammer. Whatever. I don't know. How are we doing on buildings? We will have to destroy buildings eventually to fit anything. If we want to make any more buildings, we're going to have to destroy more. But let's just fill up what we have left here. We got 2 cabbage fields, 3 pastures. So we're at 5 out of 10. We do not have enough wood. We should have enough wood by tomorrow to build everything we want. So I'm going to count on us constantly having more wood. Let's get the gathering here. We got plenty of sandstone. Let's actually put Bolilut towards getting more wood. Oh, we are out of wood. Okay, let's get a lot more wood then. Because we have plenty of sandstone, but not enough wood, so let's make sure we start getting more wood towards building those buildings. We will fill ourselves up on buildings. Oh, we got levels. Adrenaline boost. That's new. Strength, health, shielding, health, poison. Well, still no strength in Agatha, but whatever. Looks like another vegetable patch got done. It is nighttime. I'm gonna actually wait out the night. And we attracted a new villager. That is one of the best things about getting a lot of buildings, especially really fast. You will attract people. Like I said, where it said plus two to attract human, randomly, you will get people joining us. We got Vrokoslava. So that's a hunter. Hunters are basically a mixture between gatherers and warriors. They have a lot of skills. Herbalism, animal kinship, and can also fight. They're fantastic to send with your warrior group. If you attract people, they also come with their own gear. So she came with a crossbow and a short sword. Let's give her the pavise. I think that's good enough for now. I'm actually going to keep her in town for now. They also have a lot of gathering skill. She's not going to be very good. We'll put her at gathering grain for now. Okay, no changes. One more night. It's morning. Let's go start beating things up. We got plenty of food now. Going to combat with these guys. Opponents go first. Ooh, that's tough. That's really big. We have one card we can use. I'm going to put Svitoslava out there first, so she'll use her spear, hit him for a little bit of damage, and then go first there. That is a tough guy. That thing is really tough. And that thing just came out, so I can't confuse it now. If I had confused, it would confuse the skeleton instead. So let's give her some more shields, so she doesn't get wounded. Send out Radzim. And we don't have to worry about these two tactics things. Hopefully we can take these things down. Let's give him some more shields too. Oh man, we're going to get wounded people in this one. Now, he has a piercing weapon, but since the skeleton was the last one to go and not Radzim, the piercing weapon did not hit Radzim. This is going to hurt a lot. Yes! Oh no, 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 no! Crap. Okay, we have very likely just lost this combat. She killed him. Shit. Yep, we just lost this really badly. Oh my god. We're actually going to forfeit this challenge. We cannot beat these guys. There's just two left. I'm going to try and run. Everybody got wounded. Oh man, everybody got wounded. So Radzim, Luboslava, Svitoslava are heavily wounded. They might die in the night. Sveslava and Agatha are wounded but not dead. So let's camp. Hope that my medic... You can still put people to production. It doesn't change anything. And I'm going to hope that my medic skill in Agatha can actually save people. If any of my warriors die, it's game over. I mean... We're on a difficult challenge, so things go very badly. Nobody died in the night, but people are still heavily wounded. Svitoslavka is still in danger of dying. She's better, but she's still in grave danger right now. And the heart is gone, meaning nobody is in danger anymore. Good. So people are still wounded. They're not in danger of death, though. Which was a huge, huge worry. Let's break camp and we'll just avoid these ruins. Oh my god, what is that? Gates. I've never seen that before. Let's camp again, because if these things attack me, I'm probably screwed, and some of my people are still wounded. Yeah, Luboslav, Radzim, Svitoslavica are still really wounded. I've never seen that before. I don't know what that is. Let's go back to Rustopia, look around. They're building them out of the pasture here. We have two more buildings we can build, so let's fill that with another cabbage field. And that will fill all of my buildings. I could do grain. I didn't even think of that, actually. Will the grain be better? Oh my god, I've been wasting research points this whole time. I actually have to destroy my cabbage fields and replace them with grain instead. God damn. So, we're gonna literally destroy every single cabbage field we have. Normally, this would be really bad. It'll give me a little bit of the resources back. But, by doing this, we can build a total of 5 cabbage fields, and each one of those will get us 7 research points, which is much, much better than the pasture. Actually, can we stop this pasture, waste the resources? Yeah, we can do pasture with grain too. God damn it. I have to start over on every single building. Yep, that'll give me more research points too. God, I wasted all of that. Let's destroy our pastures too. We'll start over. Bring our pastures up to 5 as well, and we'll be getting lots of research points for that. That was a huge waste of resources, but since we got so lucky in our first turn and what we can gather, I'm not worried about it. I am worried about up here, though. Okay, I don't want to attack that because I don't know what it is. This, however, looks safe. Let's look and see if anybody is still wounded. A little bit. Little bit, but I feel safe. No, I don't feel safe with this many monsters around. I will camp again. Nothing to gather.
In the midst of your day's work, a vision appears in all your minds at once. You see a calm lake, as if untouched by any darkness. In the middle of the lake, there stands a lone figure, beckoning you to join her.
Oh, clearly I'm going to her. We better check it out at some point. So, this is the Divine Quest. The Divine Quest, if you can complete it, gives you a crap ton of experience. And does not end the game. Skeletons! Oh my god. What the hell? Wow. Ouch. So I could probably take down one of these skeletons, but Svitoslavka is hideously heavily injured. I'm not going to risk it. Plus, we're low on food. Is there any food nearby? There's seaweed down here. Let's go down one. Camp. Start gathering some seaweed for food. That was ouchy.
You see fresh boar tracks. It looks like a large bag.
I am Svitoslavka is still heavily injured. We'll leave it alone. Okay, we got 1 research point because of the vegetable garden being complete. This is going to actually get us a hell of a lot of research, which is great. Going to go to crafting, go for shields first. Now let's head back to town because we actually got something now, which can use the metal that we've been getting. We've been getting a lot of metal. Silver. And we've been getting a lot of gems, too. Now, depending on the rarity, the thing about gems, we'll show you really quick here. So, I can put leather, wood, or gems. So, if I put the dark wood in, it gives 12 plus 2 dexterity, 2 armor, 8 shielding. However, with gems, let's see what was the difference there. Gems give way more research points. Damn, I did that wrong. Gems give way more research points and give a random property to the thing you're making. So we're making a Destiny Shield with this material right now, which is fantastic for this early in the game. We'll put that up there. We'll see what else we can make. Can we make another one of those? We can make another one of those. Wow. However, I don't want to use all of my materials. Actually, let's cancel those because I forgot we had that topaz. Silver. Some topaz. 16. 7 armor, 10 shielding. That's a great shield. And then silver, and then The Malachites. Another one, it's a little bit worse, not 10 shielding, it's one less on armor and shielding, but it's still really damn good. We don't have enough topaz to finish the other one anyway. Sending that down to the bottom. Once we are done with all the constructing, which is going to take forever, then we'll start on these shields. Shields are fantastic. Okay, how are we doing? She is... Everybody's at full. Okay, we can leave. We're still low on food, but I'm assuming we'll be okay. Let's go. Damn it. People just keep getting injured by these auto-resolves. It doesn't feel like they should be. We totally wasted the labor at that last place. Oh well. Let's skip 2 days here. Get a little bit more food with them. And then move on. And because we keep getting injured, let's actually go into combat here. It's... Oh, the opponent's going first. Whoop. And she'll do 17. She cannot kill that in one shot. We can't confuse it now. Damn. Oh! They did a first action on that one. So it's now going first. Let's confuse this unliving corpse. So that one is going to get the first shot. I'll shield Svidoslavka here so she can take the shot from the broken skeleton. And then we'll just send in everybody else to finish it off. Hopefully we won't take any damage here. So it'll hit Svidoslavka, but the shields will hold out. And we'll just kill this thing off. And then hit that thing. We will take a little bit of damage. So Svidoslavka will get injured. But it's okay. It's not bad. And we won. Yeah, she took one damage. I'm going to head towards this area up here. I really want to get some more food. But I'm assuming we're okay for now. More undead. No reason to hold camp here. Everybody's fully health. At full health. Every time. I really need to get my people some better shields and armor. So that we stop getting wounded every time we go into an auto-resolve. Let's take the stuff. So I could stay and fight and get better stuff. I'm not going to. Because that's a 3 difficulty. And if I'm getting wounded in 1 difficulties, I am not ready. Let's head down towards this cosmic tree thing here. If I go up here, it'll be 1 movement to get down there. Or 2 movement. They can take crows, I'm not worried about that. Let's start the cosmic tree quest.
Of the sacred
is clearly scribbled in a hurry by an unknown author. The elves seek to diminish our work. No surprise there. I must get to this grove before they can meddle with mankind again. The Sage Tower should give me some clues as to how to stop the elves. The darkness is a side effect for sure, but I'll be damned if I let the magic rule man again. The rest of the notes are too damaged to read.
Right, so there are two locations to scout. Perhaps we should check them out. So, that was the start of the Cosmic Tree quest. It gives you two different areas that you can explore for the next part of the quest. But I've given you what my goal was, which was a good starting tutorial for Thea the Awakened. So I'm going to end this here right now. If you really want to see more of what I'm doing, go ahead, subscribe. Go ahead, follow me on Twitch, where I do stream Thea the Awakening. And I hope you all enjoyed. I'm OmniRusted, and I'll see you later.